Penn Cottage, and with the flat was at the back of Denham Studios. And my father was a very good amateur actor. He was the son of actors. used to perform with the Denham Amateur Dramatic Society, which used to perform at Denham Hall, and Denham Hall, Denham Village Hall, and it happened to be three doors down from where David Lean lived. And David Lean, on a stormy night, short of petrol, I no doubt, like everybody else in those days, went to see my father play the station master in Ghost Train. And my dad was powerful. He was a powerful actor. And David Lean, bless his heart, he was so impressed. He went round the back of Denham Village Hall and praised him and said, "Hey, if you're ever, Arnold, if you're ever interested in taking this up professionally, come and see me." And this was a red rag to a starved bull. So my father thought about it and finally got on his bicycle and went round and saw David Lean, who by this time had forgotten all about it. Anyway, they gave him a gin, which is something he'd never had. And David Lean was quite kind, said that, "Well, of course, it's a very tricky profession. Don't give up your day job. I'll keep you in mind. Have you got any children? We're looking for children." So Dad, desperately disappointed, said, "Well, I've got two, and a very young one." He said, well, "Will you bring them round, see if they're any good?" So we were, my elder brother and I were paraded round to the front of, to the offices at the front of Denham Studios, and looked at by the producers and by David Lean. And then I came in and I would look soppy with red hair. I had bright red hair in those days. And David Lean thought, "Well, there's a soppy looking boy." And of course we talked the Queen's English, King's English. My mother was insistent on that. And anyway, she talked like that, you see. And I talked like that. She was very sweet to me and she was very nice. And it was a day's filming and a day's standby, £8. I'd never had so much money in my life. But in those days, you didn't have a chaperone. I was taken across by Dad or Mum, I think, and just left and escorted onto the set, where I had to change into pyjamas in a carriage, which was part of the next day's filming. I'm intensely embarrassed that my willy might pop out in my pyjamas, I remember, and felt very ill at ease. But anyway.
You'd have been fighting again. They won't go to sleep until you go in and talk to them about it.
Mummy, is that you, Mummy?
Yes, Margaret?
Come upstairs at once, Mummy. I want to talk to you.
You're both very naughty. You should have been asleep hours ago. Now, what is it, you two?
Well, Mummy, tomorrow's my birthday, and I want to go to the circus. And tomorrow's not Margaret's birthday, and she wants to go to the pantomime.
My birthday's in June, and there aren't any pantomimes in June.
It's far too late to discuss it tonight, and if you don't go to sleep at once, I shall tell Daddy not to let you go to either.
Oh, Mummy.
Well, why not take them to both, one in the afternoon?
But I was interested the bit where after I was knocked over, I was lying in bed. Lean had got a marvellous tracking shot from the door back to let me in foreground as she comes to the room. It was the right shot, you know. I look at it now with my aged eyes of time of experience as a director. And the first time we did it, the cameraman shouted, "Cut! The boy's got his eyes open!" Because I was looking to see what was happening. So Lean said to me, "Just shut your eyes and let us get on with our job," or words to that effect. At the end of that day's filming, this is a moment I will never forget. She did her bit, and in the stories, this has happened just after she'd nearly had a full affair with Trevor Howard. And David Lean, I was lying in bed, and David Lean leaned across to her, so I got the two faces, left and right, in foreground, about sort of 5 or 6 inches from me. And he said, "Bloody good, Celia. Just
Celia Johnson, of course. Yes.
Celia Johnson. And it's the first time I'd ever heard bloody used as a pleasant rather than an expletive. And and the two eyes, he had basilisk eyes and so did she. And I always say, the eyes won. From that moment, looking between those two, I said, this is what I want to do. Now, I remember in the evening, suddenly they shouted, cut time. And I was left alone in the studio two at Denham Studio, big studio. And I didn't know what to do, and I'd forgotten totally that I'd undressed in a carriage. And I was just starting to cry when a marvellous woman called Frances Dillon, bloody good designer, one of our best art directors, and somebody I knew, because she used to stay in a house round the back, and we knew her a bit, and she said, "Hello, Richard, how'd it go? What's the matter?" I said, "I don't know." She worked it out. She said, "Well, there you are. You pop in there and get dressed and I'll take you home." So I walked home hand in hand with Frances Dillon, by which time I was happy as a sandbar, couldn't stop talking, and flourishing the £5 which I'd been given for the day's filming in my hand, which I was so excited about, I lost halfway across the field. And she and I, this famous, wonderful woman, were on our hands and knees looking for silver in the middle of the long grass. Anyway, that was the end of that.
Lovely.